God the praise and the glory. We give God the praise and the glory, church, because it starts at Calvary. If we didn't have the story that was told at Gethsemane, if we didn't have the story that was told, because it started right in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus Christ bore the ultimate agony of what salvation he has to go through so that salvation can come to you and I. It starts right there, church. And when we think of what Jesus Christ did for us at Calvary's cross, that if there was no Calvary, then where would we be? We would never be able to know the heritage or heritage, what it's all about. That Jesus Christ died, that Jesus Christ prevailed, that Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, sets this pace. The middle wall of separation was broken down. And everything that we talk about in terms of what separates us from the living God, it was broken down, church. And we have the victory. And we give God the praise and the glory because of the victory to Jesus Christ. That even when evil seems to be prevailing, that God's people can stand their ground and be at ease to know that it will never happen. It looks like at times. Because when you look around you, and you see what is going on day by day. When you look around you, sometimes you want to think, where is God in all this? People continue to ask this question. When you see young children are murdered, they are raped, violated, families are torn apart. My God, just because of war. Folks are raising up themselves as people of God and they're destroying one another in the name of religion. I tell you, the earth is in chaos. The world is in chaos. But we are confident. Sometimes we look at it and folks ask, if there is a God, why do these things happen? Why is it that God does not intervene? Why doesn't God stop all of this? When we're going through our trials and tribulation, and we know that in our hearts that we are obedient children of God, we do everything according to what God says in His Holy Scriptures. We are obedient. We don't lie. We don't steal. We don't covet. Hallelujah. My God, we pay our tithes consistently. We don't cut, we don't trim, we don't rob God. And yet, when we look, we are day by day faced with different trials and tribulations. I'm talking about children of God who love God with all their hearts. That they are consistent in their relationship with the Almighty God. They know who they are in Christ Jesus. Amen. They stand firm my God, on the promises of Almighty God. And yet day by day, they go through so many different trials. Sometimes it looks like the enemy would be winning the big victory. The enemy has the victory. Sometimes it looks like the enemy has the battle is being won by the enemy. It looks like that sometimes, church. But I'm confident in the God that I serve. Because in the days of Habakkuk, Habakkuk had problems with that too. He looked around and he saw that, my God, the evil folks in those times, it seems as if they were prevailing over the righteous people of God. And Habakkuk had some questions for Almighty God. If we turn to Habakkuk 1 from 1 to 4, we're going to see the dialogue that Habakkuk, the prophet, had with Jehovah God. He says, "Oh Lord, how long shall I cry? And you will not hear. Even cry out to you violence, and you will not save. Why do you show me iniquity and cause me to see trouble? For plundering and violence are before me. There is strife and contention arises. Therefore the law is powerless." The law, it is the same thing, church. Sometimes the law abiding folks, my God, when we try to abide by the law, those who are there to protect the law or to administer the law, they are worse than the criminals. I can tell you that. So Habakkuk saw those things in his son. And he continues to say, "And justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous. Therefore, perverse judgment proceeds." And we are asking the question, same. It is the same question that God's people sometimes ask in these times of trials and tribulation. But I am here to comfort God's people to know that God is still alive and God is still seated on the throne on high, that God is in total control. Because in Ecclesiastes 3 from 1 to 2 and 14, the word reminds us that to everything there is a season. A time for every purpose under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. I know that whatever God does or allows, it shall be forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it that men should fear before him. So God is allowing some things to happen sometimes for us to be under the fear of Almighty God, to look up to our God and to know that God is in control. God is never going to lose no control, church. I can tell you that. Amen. That our God is seated on high, that he remains forever and ever, that there is no change in Jehovah God. The same God who flung the earth into space and created you and I. The same God who does everything for his people, the children of Israel. He rained manna from heaven for them. My God Almighty, he opened the rocks and brought a gush out for them to drink when they were thirsty. The same God who put a road through the Red Sea for his children to walk. It's the same God that we serve. Yes. So when we look to God, my God Almighty, and when evil seems to be prevailing over the righteous, because this is what the title of this message is. When evil seems to be prevailing over the righteous, let God's people stand still.
Yes.
You should never be moved, church. Because you know that if you remain grounded in Almighty God, if your anchor holds deep, in the love of Almighty God and His promises, that God is going to bring you through whatever you're going through. No matter what the devil might mimic you and tell you, no matter he might remind you that you're a failure, no matter why he will tell you that you won't be winning this battle, you better give it up. You can remain confident in God.
Amen.
You should. Habakkuk saw evil.
Yes.
And it seemed as if evil was prevailing over the righteous. And he went to God again a second time. If you go to Habakkuk 1, we're sitting in the Word of God. And if from verses 12 to 17, Habakkuk had another second question for God. He says, "Are you not from everlasting, O Lord my God,
my
Holy One? We shall not die, Lord.
Yes, Jesus.
My God, you have appointed them for judgment.
Yes.
O rock, you have marked them for correction.
Yes.
You are of clearer eyes than to behold evil and cannot look on wickedness. Why do you look on those who deal treacherously and hold your tongue when the wicked devours a person more righteous than he? Why do you make men like fish of the sea, like creeping things that have no ruler over them? They take up all of them with a hook. They catch them in their net and gather them in their trap net. Therefore they rejoice and are glad. Therefore they sacrifice to their net and burn incense to their trap net, because by them their shear is sumptuous and their food plentiful. Shall they therefore empty their net and continue to slay nations without pity?" Habakkuk emptied his heart before God.
Yes.
Sometimes you have to really empty your heart before God. When you're going through some stuff, church, oh, glory to God. At night, you sometimes have to get up and ask God, "Are you still alive? Are you still caring for me? Do you still love me, Lord God?" Oh, yes, sometimes, my God, when it looks as if the evil one is prevailing over the righteous. Oh, yes, my God, you are tempted to ask God those questions. You have to bombard the gates of heaven to ask those questions, church. And yes, when you ask, then you got to wait on God, and God will give you an answer. If you will just tarry in the presence of God and wait patiently on God,
hallelujah,
you will get a response. Habakkuk, when he asked God the second question, Habakkuk says, "I will stand my watch and set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say to me and what I will answer when I am corrected." So Habakkuk knew that God was all-knowing. And despite that, he had some questions, that God can correct him and say, "Listen to me, my dear son. It's not like that. It seems as if evil is prevailing over the righteous. But I am still Jehovah God."
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Glory be to God. And the word of God continues to state that God answered.
Yes.
He says, "Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision."
Yes, sir.
Write it and make it plain on tablets, that he may run who reads it. For the vision, church, is yet for an appointed time. Oh, yes. But at the end, it will speak.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
And it will not lie.
Hallelujah.
Though it tarries, oh, you gotta wait for it.
Yes, Lord.
Because it will surely come.
Yes,
glory be to God. It will not tarry. Behold, the proud, his soul is not upright in him, but the just shall live by faith.
Yes.
Even though you don't see it and you don't know how it's going to pan out, even though you don't see any way, my God, through the wilderness, even though when it looks as if you're going to be killed in this process, even though when it seems as if you're going to lose everything you have, even though when it seems that everybody is against you, oh yes, even though when it looks like you're surrounded by the enemy's camp, you can be confident that they just have to live by faith, that when you don't see how God is going to do it, that you still have to believe your God, and you know that God is in control, that he's no God who sins and he's not going to do, that our God is able, church, he's not a God who is disabled, I can tell you, he's a potent God, and he's able, my God, he's able, he's able, yes, our God is able, yes, he is able, I'm here to declare it today, that our God is able.
Hallelujah.
He's able.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Jesus.
Jesus is able.
My Lord.
Our God is able.
Yes.
And we must, as children of God, not forget that. No matter what you go through, no matter what your body is telling you,
hey,
you got to be able to stand upright and say, my body is saying something, but I know God is saying something else. And I am going to believe what God says. I'm not going to believe anything else.
Amen. Amen.
Though it seems as if evil is prevailing over the righteous, I am going to stand my ground. I am going to dig my feet deep in the Almighty God. I'm going to wait patiently on God, because those who wait on the Lord, they shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagle. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. So God has to teach us
how to wait.
How to wait on him. Because sometimes you are near to the edge for that victory. Just right at the little tip. God is carrying you through. And you're on the brink of victory, my God. And because you get weary and faint-hearted, you got to sometimes, folks, give it all up, my God, and they allow the evil one to prevail over them. You can't blame God if you do that.
That's right.
Because God tells you to wait.
Yes.
That the vision is for an appointed time. That it might tarry. But if it tarries, you got to wait.
Amen.
Wait on it. Because it's coming. The word continues to state in Daniel 3. And we read it this morning. We read the story of Daniel. Daniel, a mighty man of God, that Nebuchadnezzar set up a gold image and said that everybody should worship him. And I know in my heart that I ain't worshiping no gold image, because I know that the gold image can't help me. And Daniel knew that too, that no golden image could be of help to him. Because you see, Daniel knew the God that he served. He was confident in that God. And the word continues to state from 8 to 18. We read it this morning that Nebuchadnezzar had some folks. They were no good folks. The evil folks. Just the same as the folks that sometimes are living today. That they will come at God's people to scoff at God's people and to say that you are going to go under. And they will set up different lies against you. The devil has anointed some folks, just as when God anoints his people. The devil has his folks that he anoints to go out there and to trouble God's people. But I am here to declare it this day and forever, that though it may look like evil is prevailing over the righteous, that we ought to stand our ground, because it will never ever happen. Daniel, my God, stood his ground. Ain't worshiping no gold image. Because if I talk to a gold image, the golden image can't respond to me. And I talk to my God day by day. So why should I lift up and worship a golden image. And he stood his ground. He said, I'm not doing it. You see, sometimes God's people have to go against the odds, no matter what is coming. That you who know what you know, that God is expecting that we should stand up for righteousness.
Hallelujah.
Folks want you to compromise sometimes and want you to agree with them. But you must stand your ground and say, agree with that, because it is wrong in the sight of God that if God's word go against it, I am going to go against it too.
Amen.
That's what Daniel did. Daniel knew his God. As a child, he worshipped that God. He knew and he had experienced the power of that God. And the God, the man, the prophet says, no, I ain't doing it. And we know what happened. We know Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego ended up in a fiery furnace.
Yes.
The word continues to state that Shadrach says, look, ain't doing it. But what really got to my heart was that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego says, look, we ain't worshiping that gold image. That they declared, they made a declaration. They said that it does not matter what happens. If God allows us to be tossed into that fiery furnace, that does not say that our God cannot deliver. And that is what God's people, we have to get to a level of confidence in our God. That sometimes God might decide that he's not going to make the move then. That does not say or discredit the power of Almighty God.
Amen.
He is still Jehovah God. And when they stood up before Nebuchadnezzar felt in his heart, hey, we're not going to go and talk with that fiery furnace. And he ordered them to turn up the fiery furnace 7 times hotter than how it would normally be. And they went ahead and did it. And glory be to God, when they tossed, the word continues to confirm that they tossed the 3 Hebrew boys into that fiery furnace. And when they were watching to see that they turned, their bodies were charred. When they look, they saw 4 men walking. Nebuchadnezzar jumped to his feet and says, wait a minute. He says, didn't we show 3 men in that fire? He says, look, there's a 4th in that fire. And the 4th one looked like the Son of the living God. Oh my God Almighty, who told that man?
Yes.
Who told him?
My God.
Who told him that this 4th image was the Almighty God himself, who turned up in the fire? Church, God will turn up in that fire for you. If you stand your ground and you decide to give that praise to Almighty God, that God will turn up in whatever fire you find yourself in. Whether it's a medical fire, God will turn up in it. Whether it is a financial fire, God will turn up into it. It might be a different, no matter what the situation is, you know your situation. God will turn up in it if you decide in your heart that you're not going to sell out your God. That's what happened, my God, to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And because of that, the enemy who wanted to destroy them, the word confirms that they turned around and praised the Most High God.
Yes.
And that's what you do when you stand up for righteousness.
Yes.
Folks will turn around when they see God working for you. They're going to turn around and bless.
Yes.
That God that you serve. And that is why God's people should always stand up. And the word I'm just going to go through quickly about Nebuchadnezzar's word of worship to the living God instead of the golden image. The word says, and I'm in Daniel 3 and verses 28. He says, Nebuchadnezzar spoke saying, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his angel and delivered his servants who trusted in him. And they have frustrated the king's word and yielded their bodies that they should not serve nor worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree that any people, nation, language which speaks anything amiss against God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be burned to an ash heap, because there is no other God who can deliver by this. Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the promised province of Babylon.
Amen.
My God Almighty, then don't you know that Psalm 105 from 13 to 15 is true? Because the word confirms that when they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another people, he permitted no one to do them wrong. Yes, he rebuked kings for their sakes, saying, do not touch my anointed ones, and do my prophets no harm. Because God indeed charges our light and our salvation. He truly is. Then who should we fear? We don't have anyone to fear, my God. Because when the enemy wicked came up against me to eat up my flesh, that's what David confirms. He says, my enemies and my foes, they stumbled and fell. We serve a mighty God, church. We serve a God who is in control. That no matter what the devil will form any weapon against us. The word of God confirms in Isaiah 45, Isaiah 54 and 17, that they will never prosper.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
And every tongue that rises up in judgment, that God is going to give you that power and authority to condemn those tongues. So that is the heritage of God's people. And God's people need then to stand firm and to have your anchor deep. I was reading this story which really intrigued me. And it was about an evangelist who went to evangelize. And he was doing some great things for the week. It was a week of evangelistic work that he was committed to do. And the evangelist went and he started in a tent outside. And people were in the tent, filled the tent. And then all of a sudden, the thunder started to roll and lightning started to flash. And the evangelist went to God and says, God, here I am. I am here and there are so many people who are gathered to hear your word. And he says, you cannot allow any rain to fall. He said, you stop the rain, my God Almighty. And you have the power to stop the rain. So I'm asking you, don't you shower any rain now. And the evangelist prayed a prayer so that everyone could hear, thinking that God would have done as he asked. But the story went on to say that as he said amen, that a shower of rain came down and nearly washed the tent away. And all the people dashed out of the tent and scampered and they ran away and left the evangelist by himself. And the evangelist says, no, this is not for me. I am going to give it up. This God that I am here standing and talking and telling people that he's a good God and he's a powerful God, he decided he's not stopping the rain. I am throwing in my towel. I can't be bothered with this nonsense. This is a fake God I have been worshiping all along. And he went away and went into the village, and he found a bar and he started to drink. And when he was there, he drank until he was drunk and laid on the floor. And as he was laying on the floor, there came a man who came in. The man came in the bar, and the man says, "Get up, what are you doing on the floor?" The evangelist, leave me alone. I don't want to talk to anyone. And the man says, "No, you have to get up." He says, "You have everything to be thankful to your God for. Why are you lying there?" And the evangelist says, "I'm not going to worship this God anymore." The man looked at him and said, "You need to worship this God, because I'm going to tell you something." He says, "I control this entire village for 45 years. I've been using and worshiping the devil in this village for 45 years. And since you came into town, you have broken everything down. And I cannot get to ever do anything for the devil anymore." And he says, "I said I was bent on going to kill you." He says, "I pull out every kind of book in divination to tear you down, and when I looked, it was a big ball of fire around you, and I can't touch you."
Yes, sir.
The evangelist was there looking. He says, "When I tried the last time, and when I couldn't permeate the fire, I said, 'I'm going to go for my bullets, my gun, and a gun must take you down.' And he says, 'My gun used gunpowder.' And I took up a bag of gunpowder to go to stack it in and to shoot you down. But he says, as I put the gunpowder in place, there came a shower of rain and wet up all the gunpowder. And that was it. I couldn't touch you." And he says, "I'm here to tell you,
my Lord. Jesus."
He says, "I'm here to declare that the God that you serve is a mighty God." Your God is awesome.
Yeah.
Oh yes. And that evangelist had a lot to cry to God to ask for forgiveness. Church, we don't know how God is going to work it out.
Yeah.
We don't know how he's going to do it. Glory be to God.
Yes.
But our duty is to continue to trust God. And to know that he's not going to allow the wicked one to prevail over you. It might look like he's prevailing, but he's not going to ever allow it.
Never.
If you ever see that happen, I have never, David says, I've been young and I've been old. Never have I seen the righteous forsaken and their seeds beg bread. God is not a God like that. He is the true God. God, and he's also our refuge and strength. He's a present help in trouble. Therefore, we should not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, says Psalm 46. Though the mountains shake with its swelling, there is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is stands in the midst of her.
Hallelujah.
She shall not be moved.
Hallelujah.
God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations rage, the kingdoms removed, and God uttered his voice, and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us.
The God of Jacob.
The God of Jacob is our refuge. My God Almighty. So we give God the praise and the glory. Those who trust in God are like Mount Zion.
That never be removed.
That will never be removed.
Never.
But abide forever.
Amen.
So the mountains surround Jerusalem.
Oh, the
so the Lord surrounds his people.
Israel.
Oh yes.
Mm.
He surrounds the righteous.
Yes.
He puts a ball of fire.
Mm.
And only if you could ask God to open your eyes to see that ball of fire around you. When the enemy is about to take you down, when he thinks that he can mess you up,
yes.
Hear what? God is with you. And he might not deliver you when you want him to deliver you. That's the story. He delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But the word confirms in Acts chapter 7, that brother Stephen was not delivered. That Stephen, a man of God, a righteous man, oh yes, that he faced some angry folks. He faced some demons from hell, and they were able to stone him to death. And God sat there and watched and never moved. And also, my God Almighty, not only will brother Stephen, my God Almighty, but also with brother Peter. Brother Peter, who preached the gospel of Jesus Christ and stood for it, he ended up on a cross, and Peter asked to be crucified upside down because he was not worthy to be crucified in the direction that his Savior was crucified. And he was taken out.
Mm-hmm.
And Brother Paul, who preached the gospel of Jesus Christ and was whipped for it and was put into jail over and over again, in the final end, his enemies prevailed and they beheaded him. And God was still seated on the throne and watched it happen. And not only Stephen, Peter, and Brother Paul, but Jesus Christ, his only son. Hey, the son of the living God. Face angry folks who said, crucify him. Crucify him, he's no king. We don't need him. Give us the two thieves instead of him. And God sat there and watched his only son. Got crucified. Whipped. Beaten, spat upon, a thorn of crown was placed on his head instead of a thorn, instead of a crown of gold. And God sat there and watched. And you will ask, why does God do all of that? Why does he work like that when he has the power and the authority to stop things? But Isaiah 55 from 8 to 11 confirms and says, for his thoughts are not our thoughts,
yes, Lord,
nor his ways our ways. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. For as high as the heavens is from the earth, so are the ways of Almighty God higher than ours, as well as his thoughts. For if the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. He says, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please,
yes,
and it shall prosper,
yes,
in the thing for which I sent it. So God is in control. Our God is in control when everything seems to to be out of control. When it is bad and dreary, our God is in control. So though we are cast down, church, as 2 Corinthians 4 and from 7 to 18 confirms. And I'm going to go through this word and I am going to close this message. The word says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed.
Yep.
We are perplexed, but not in despair.
Yep.
Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed.
Yes.
Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus,
yes,
that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So then death is working in us, but life in you. God's everlasting love is still there for us. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day by the powerful mighty God. For our light affliction, says the word of God, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. What then shall we say? Say Romans 8, 31 to 39. If that is so, what then shall we say then? If God is for us, who can be against us? If God is for us, who can be against us? My God, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of Almighty God, which is in Christ Jesus. You may ask, where is God when you're going through your trials and tribulations? When you're going through all the persecutions that life can bring at times? When the devil seems resolute to take you in? Where is God in all this? Where is he? Is he sleeping? Is he all tucked in his pajama? Our God does not sleep. He has no time to sleep, church. He's still in control. He never loses control. So though he might allow us to go through some things, let us still know that he loves us. He cares for us. When evil seems to be prevailing over the righteous, remember that God is in control. Let us pray and give God thanks. Loving Heavenly Father, we praise you and we give you the glory and we honor you, mighty God, and we bless your holy name. Glory be to God. We thank you, God, for the power that you give to us through your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your word of truth, mighty God. We thank you that our hearts are assured that even though, Lord God, our bodies are perishing day by day, even though we are broken in spirits of time, Lord God, even though tribulation seems that it is going to consume us at time, Lord God, we are thankful that your word today Lord God, comfort us, our hearts, that your word affirms, mighty God, that even when it looks like evil is prevailing over the righteous, that you are still in total control. We give our hearts to you. We give our wills unto you. We surrender our lives to you, mighty God. And we say, have your way, Lord. Have your way, God, your almighty potter. We are just pieces of clay. Make us and mold us after your will. Here we are, Lord. We are totally surrendered and well. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, God's children, we'll agree and say, amen.